Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's broadcast of the ECBL playoffs here in Hartsville, South Carolina. I am Marcus Shockley, and I'm going to turn it over to our broadcast man of the day, Chase Vaden. Chase, take it away.
Thank you, Marcus. It's a great day outside of this building, and it's going to be another great day inside as we've got some great action lined up for you here on Netcast Sports. Up first, we are going to have the Northern Conference Final for the ECBL. It's going to be the Carolina Thunder going up against the North Carolina Coyotes. It'll be some high-powered matchup. If you haven't caught any of the action with us before, be prepared for a whole lot of scoring. On our way here, we talked about it. You'll see a team later who's averaging 142 points a game. The primetime players, they'll be coming up on our broadcast around 7 o'clock. But first, as I mentioned, we've got the Carolina Thunder going up against the Coyotes here for the Northern Conference Final.
You know, Chase, I see that we have 22.1 seconds on the clock, but it's stuck. So I don't know. Well, I guess that answers our question. You hear the buzzer.
They just wanted to make sure they were ready for us.
Mark, there's a battery.
So one thing, Chase, I'll step out of your way in just a moment as the teams are getting their final information before the game, but I just want to let people at home know that one of the things about the scoreboard that you'll see on screen today is not the official scoreboard. We are doing our best to keep up with the one in the gym. So what I'm really saying is do not tweet or email us that the score is wrong. We're simply going by what is on the scoreboard here.
As best we can.
As best we can. We will do our best to keep up. So, but that'll be coming up in just a moment. You can follow the ECBL on Twitter, as Chase had mentioned, and of course, he will be handling all of your play-by-play today. And we'll be bringing in some expert commentary later in the broadcast to give us some breakdown.
The Louisville legend,
and not Chris Paul. The other Louisville legend.
There's only two,
but I understand.
We have the best one.
I understand that they're having some shirts made. That's how you know it's legit. All right, we're going to step aside for the national anthem.
Sure, you caught that beautiful rendition of the Star-Spangled Banner. I will say most of my Saturday nights I've been spent at Bowman Gray Stadium, and they've got the best barbershop quartet singing the national anthem. So that was another nice twist. As the public address announcer is introducing the ball clubs, we will, at the same time he gives them out, we'll be giving you these starting lineups for these squads. First up for the Coyotes will be number 5. That's Marquis Bunn. Along with him will be number 10. That is Will Griffin. High-powered guard out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Coming up after him is number 35. That's Corey Evans, a guard as well, out of Durham, North Carolina. Coming in is number 11. That's Robert Espinosa, the forward out of New Jersey. Rounding out the starting lineup will be Corje Cox out of Washington, North Carolina. And that will be your starting lineup for the North Carolina Coyotes. And coming in for not the Oklahoma City Thunder, but the Carolina Thunder, they come in a single file line. Nice and easy for us to check out. That's going to be number 2, Jarvis Williams. In with the starters, number 1, Trey James. Number 23, Andrew Crawford. Number 31, Devontae Washington. Come in at center. And rounding out the starters for the Thunder will be number 11, Anthony Keane. The Coyotes in the white with a slight blue trim and yellow numbers, which are fairly difficult to read on those bright white uniforms, but we will do our best to make sure you guys know who's got the ball and what they're doing with it throughout the ball game. And then if we're going to go with the jersey competition to start off with the game, I'm going to give the edge to the Houston Rockets Thunder look, the retro Houston Rockets with the pinstripes. We've got the powder blue with the orange and white pinstripes for the Thunder. And in this semifinal matchup, the Northern Conference final matchup, we will have 4 12-minute quarters. As the Thunder gain the tip, is kicked away. And that's going to go for a side out to the Thunder. That's going to be Williams inbounding it. They're going to call a walk there on number 11. Anthony Keane dragged his back foot before he could get the pass off. That's going to be an early turnover for the Thunder. And a quick step and a nice pass inside. It's tipped away, but a finish is made there by number 11, Robert Espinosa, to get the first points on the board for the Coyotes. Thunder working it inside, trying to draw a foul, doesn't get it, but gets the bucket to go. There is number 1, Trey James, the forward slash center out of Darlington, right down the road from where we are here in Hartsville. That one goes over the backboard, but a foul is called. It's going to give 2 shots there to number 35. That's Corey Evans, the guard out of Durham, North Carolina, listed here at 6'2", 185. He will have 2 shots at the stripe. First one rattles off the rim, off the backboard, and in. Has better luck than my free throw would have. And he knocks them both down. An early 4-point lead here for the Coyotes over the Thunder in this finals matchup. A 3-point jumper is off and rebounded down low by the Coyotes. 3-point shot rattles out. Rebounded there by number 1. That's James. Thunder working it around, three-point jumper off the back of the rim. Four Thunder jerseys around the ball. They get the rebound. In the corner, shots up and drained by number 11. That's Anthony King, the young guard out of Rockingham, North Carolina. That three-point jumper is off and brought down there by number 31, Devontae Washington. As the Thunder working it inside, wiggles his way in, can't get it to fall, and it's going to go out of play off. It appeared to be off of number 31, Washington. It's going to go back over to the Coyotes. As Bunn brings it up the floor for the Coyotes. Once again, those white uniforms, steps back, foot on the line. It's going to be a two, but doesn't fall, so it didn't matter. So Thunder pushes up the floor, shot right at the free throw line, rattles out, and rebounded. His foot was on the line, though, so it will stay here with the Thunder. Inbounding responsibility goes to Jarvis Williams once again. Passes in to Keene. Williams drives the lane, tries to draw the foul, can't get it, but a rebound there. Can't get the shot to go was Crawford. A nice shot up there, but can't get it to fall, but a nice rebound and finish there for number 21, Corjay Cox. Can't get it high enough off the glass. That one rattles out. Couldn't learn from his first mistake. That one didn't bounce off high either for Washington as the Coyotes chase it back down the other side. Bunn pulls up, and that one's off and rebounded there by Williams. Passes it down inside. And that one's knocked down by number 11, Anthony Keene. Nice hesitation, and that one is swarmed up by the Thunder. That was number one with the stuff slash rip. That was James as he gets the rebound and the finish right there. Great play on both coasts for Mr. James. And that one coming around was a block from Washington. Kick to the outside, and that one is buried once again by Anthony Keene. He's on fire from the outside as the timeout's going to be called by the Coyotes. They do not want this deficit to get any worse here. 4 minutes into the first quarter, the score 13-6. Thunder leading the Coyotes. On behalf of all of us here, we'd like to thank you again for joining us here on Netcast Sports. Thank you, Marcus, for bringing me on the trip. So I do appreciate that, especially you driving. That's the best part. I just get to sit there, relax, let you do all the work, and I just have to come down here and talk.
And you're doing a great job, Chase. Fantastic.
And as the game comes back, I'll let you get back to your snacks.
I know what's important here.
As the action resumes here with Bunn bringing it up. I'm not sure how many more times I can say Bunn without wanting a hot dog or something like that. Three-point jumper off the back of the rim, fighting for the rebound, and the Thunder come down with it. A lot of pressure before he could get to half court as he loses it. Nice moves on the outside, gets caught. And nice spin move, drawing the foul there was number 11. That was Robert Espinosa, the young man out of Plainfield, New Jersey. He attended Shaw University. Guess it works out that he is in the Northern Conference Final. A lot of these young men are from the Carolinas, but we do have the occasional outsiders, I guess you would say, as the first one is off for Espinosa. And he sinks the second, cutting the deficit to just six. They're going to call a travel there on the extra hesitation from Keene. Disputes the call a little bit, but gets back on D. Will Griffin with it. And that one swatted away once again by Devontae Washington. He's got a couple blocks already in this game. Thought about the three there was Keen as he gets the pass back. Nice ball movement. Couldn't get the finish, but there a nice rebound and better defense as learning from his first mistakes is Washington finishing close to the rim. Pull-up jumper there is good from Evans. And a foul is going to be called against the Coyotes. Looked like they called it on number five. That's Mr. Marquis Bunn. He as well attended Shaw University. Coming in for the Thunder is number 10, that's James Richardson. He'll come in for Andrew Crawford. And he immediately is going to shoot. That one is off and rebounded. The jumper in the corner from Bunn is good. Nice shot there with a hand in his face from number 10, Richardson. But dead eyes it from the corner. And a nice pass down inside with Washington with his second straight bucket down low. And a deep shot in Curry range, doesn't get it to fall, and rebounded there by number one, Trey James for the Thunders. Williams brings it up once again, kicks it to James, but that's going to go off of him and to the Coyotes. Media timeout. They're going to take a media timeout. We do appreciate that. I'm not used to working events or anything where we get a media timeout, so we appreciate you, Mr. Referee, for giving us a break.
You know, Chase, now is a good time to mention that you can watch all these games live and in replay on netcastsports.com. We're grateful to the ECBO for allowing us to come in and broadcast their playoffs. It's a great league, a minor league in the area. They really do appreciate it. And they get ready to bump a little bit and have a little party here in the gym. Everybody just sit back and the players try to figure out what they did wrong and what they did right. You know, it's been a little bit of low scoring first half. I know that may surprise people, but for minor league, we expect it to be about, well, we still got about 5.5, so plenty of time for them to bump it up to about 30-30.
We're just about half over, like you mentioned, in the first. And, you know, these guys maybe traveled a little bit to get to the gym. So let the restless legs loosen up a little bit. I'm sure we'll see some high scoring as the young men get off the benches and start firing up some more shots.
But, you know, you mentioned getting to the gym. One thing I like about this gym, it's nice. This is a nice gym. We're out in Hartsville, South Carolina. Haven't been here before. Very up to date. Rubber floor. I know some players do like that. Some players don't. But
at the end of the day, it's a floor to play on. And a lot of these guys, I saw a video on Twitter last night of a bunch of guys playing basketball at a hotel, and one man had his arms out over a building with his arms in a circle so they could shoot. And I mentioned that if I was the goal, I would have a – and there's a block. I was going to mention me blocking, but a big block there from number six, Kendrick Whittington for the Thunder. Saw him in pregame. He looked like he could get up in the air, and he got up for that one as Williams saves it from going past half court. Dribbling around, kicking it back, but Bunn is there to rip that one away. Williams there, and a nice rolling finish there for Bunt. Nice hesitation move to get around, but a foul is going to be called there. A reach-in on Bunt. Looked a little clean, but referee down closer to the floor disagrees with me. And that's okay. I won't get mad at him for making me feel wrong this time anyway. So Williams with it once again. Rotation coming around for the Thunder. And that pass is tipped. Couldn't get it to finish. And a rebound down low by number 11, Espinosa once again. So he brings it up himself. A three-point jumper, no good, and rebounded by the Thunder. Number 30 bringing it up for the Thunder. It's Deshaun Bethay as Williams drives in. Nice floater. Looked like he was out of control, but proved me wrong as he finishes with the nice floater. So we talked about Louisville Legends earlier. Chris Paul has a very beautiful floater, and that looked a little bit like it as that one almost stolen away. And gliding in is number 21, B.J. Crawford, finishing, walking up the floor with his hand in the air, looking like Steph Curry, and a deep three knocked down by number 30, Deshaun Bethay, the young guard listed at 5'10 out of Latha. Nice hesitation and a handoff down low. It wasn't a pass. It was a direct handoff.
That was a nasty inside-out dribble there. Really just shook his man.
You can tell not too terrible amount of defense. A lot of guys being able to get shots up. One man including right there, number 10, James Richardson, buries that one. Another hesitation move getting to the cup. And finishing was 35. Corey Evans. A nice pump. Did not think that was going to go, but nice control there from Richardson to absorb the contact and the hesitation mid-flight and bury that jumper. And I tell you what, the MC didn't see it. I saw it a little bit, but a great play there by Corey Evans. He is getting to the cup easily and got the assist right there. Another floater. Unbelievable there by number 10. That's Richardson. And he's going to go to the line for the and one opportunity. Checking in for the Thunder big man 34, Brandon Page. And Richardson short on the free throw, brought down by Bunn. That one gathered up and stolen away by the Thunder. There was a few Thunder right there, and that is going to be another reach-in foul. Pretty much the exact same thing that happened on the other side of the floor. It's going to be the second foul against Bunn. And he will check out of the game, and coming in for him is number 4. That's Trey Day from San Antonio, Texas. If you look over, there is a dramatic difference between the benches of this Thunder squad and the Coyotes. The Coyotes have a full bench completely. And the Coyotes only have two men on their benches. That one is almost stolen away but remains with the Coyotes. Espinosa wiggles his way in, draws the foul on number 6, Whittington, and that's going to send Espinosa to the line for two shots. And as I mentioned, the weak bench from the Coyotes, a young man just steps into the gym, shoes not on, with his socks on. And that's the brother of Robert Espinosa, who's at the line right now. That is Eladio Espinosa. Both of those gentlemen from Plainfield, New Jersey. as Keene checks back into the game for the Thunder. And taking a rest will be Jarvis Williams as Espinoza sinks the second free throw. Richardson with it with the far side of the floor. And they're going to call a moving screen. That's a second quick foul there on Whittington. And I just have to say this real quick. If you get a close-up eventually here on number 11 for the Thunder, Anthony Keene, his facial features look a whole lot like Klay Thompson. Just resemblance with the goatee a little bit. As number 30 gathers up that rebound for the Thunder. Keene with into the corner, pass it back up. We have 50 seconds remaining here in the first quarter. A deep three, and that one deflected off the backboard and down. As the Coyotes bring it up the floor with 40 seconds remaining here in the first. And some swarming defense coming in, and a foul is going to be called there on the big man, number 34, Brandon Page, sending number 21, Corje Cox, to the line. Cox at the line, graduated from Mississippi Valley State in 2012. He sinks the first free throw. And the second is off, but rebounded by the Coyotes. Evans knocks down the big three and wanted a foul for the slap there on the elbow. And we've got a tied ball game here at 28. And not a lazy way and trying to save it was Keene, as he's going to get a foul called against him. He dribbled it off his foot there on the far side, smartly trying to throw it off the foot of number 10 of the Coyotes, Griffin. And it stayed with Griffin as he will go to the line after being fouled. It's going to be a 1-1 for the Coyotes here with 15 seconds remaining in the first quarter. I believe the ref called a 1-1. Not sure if it was just two free throws or not.
You know, Coyotes were trailing most of this whole first quarter, and just like that, they've come back.
You could tell a big difference in how it looked like they wanted to score more. That's exactly what happened. A three-point jumper, no good. Way off on the rebound, couldn't track it. And that one's brought down. And after the first quarter of play, the Coyotes lead 29-28 over the Thunder. We mentioned high scoring action, 29-28. Some fresh legs still waiting to get off the bench for the Thunder. Coaching staff over there trying to get their players into a good rhythm, good sets out on the floor. Coyotes don't have nearly as much to work with. They've only got 8 players listed on their roster for the game today. But that does not matter. You only have to have 5 out there on the floor, so it depends on whose 5 out there wants to win the ball game more. We'll start the second half, the second quarter. Try and get you everybody out on the floor. For the Coyotes, we have number 35, Corey Evans. As well as number 50, Raymond McKeithen. He's down low right now. Had a big size advantage, but a nice stuff there causing the jump ball was Brandon Page. And here in minor league basketball, we have actual jump balls. We don't have an arrow pointing either way. They go mano-a-mano, and winning the tip there were the Coyotes, but couldn't finish. It was Evans as Williams up finds his man streaking down the left side and falling it in is number 20, Alex Brown. That's his first bucket of the game. Nice step back, but they couldn't get the shot to fall. Was Griffin. Williams with it once again. He's had the ball in his hand a lot today, running the point for the Thunder, and that one just a little bit too far. A nice save by Griffin. Another nice save as Griffin gets awarded with it with a nice pass down low and finishing close to the rim.
That was a nice no-look pass there, Chase. Just looked like he had eyes. He was looking to the left and threw it to his right. Beautiful.
Williams trapped with it on the far side. They squeeze it back in, trying to draw the foul, but finishes. It was number one, Trey James. 3 James. Forcing the three up was Evans, but he buries it from way past the three-point line. Fantastic jumper, extending the lead for the Coyotes to two. And a three-point jumper off the front of the rim for number 23. That was Crawford, but Thunder regain it. Williams with it, penetrates, floats it up, can't get the friendly roll, and a foul is going to be called down low. Looks like it's going to go against number 50 of the Coyotes. That's McKeithen, and it will send Trey James to the line for two shots.
Winner of this game goes on, Chase, to win for the title, ECBL title, 2017. See if anybody can unseat the reigning champions. A multi-year dynasty right now. The primetime players, we'll have them coming up next game.
You know, with a name like primetime players, you have to be a good squad. As another three bomb is buried by number 10, Will Griffin once again, as Williams tries to take charge of his Thunder team, trying to get a play going, as his team is suddenly trailing by five after having solid control and finding an open man in the corner. And that one rattles out, and a big rebound, but couldn't get the actual pass to go. And it's going to be stepped out by number 20, Brown, and go back over to the Thunder.
He had all day to hit that shot, and just I don't know if he got nerves. He just, and then it went in and out.
Probably one of those things where he was just too open. He thought about it too much. Sometimes just being in the rhythm, even with a hand in the face, makes it easier, as that hand from Williams causes Griffin to lose it. And I could hear the slap from up here. And that one's going to be called against number 4 of the Coyotes, Trey Day. And if you're wondering, today is Saturday. That's my not-so-funny joke of the day so far. And that one poked out from behind by Evans, and it looked like it went off the hands of number 31, Washington. And it's going to go over to the Coyotes. Nice play there by Corey Evans to rip that out from behind. Just over 9 minutes remaining here in the second quarter. The Coyotes up 37-32 over the Thunder. And a nice play there by number 50, McKeithen, to back his man all the way down, straight to the cup.
He completely sealed his man on the inside there. And there was nothing his man could do. Undersized, and position was established.
We're going to have three shots at the line, as number 20 for the Thunder, Alex Brown, was taken down on the far side.
Yeah.
First of three. The second rattles out for Brown, and he will have one more. He only gets one of the three to fall. If you get three freebies there, you got to be able to knock them down no matter what time you are in the game. Nice pick and roll, but bad pass there from Griffin. And a terrific rip again from Evans. But Williams got it back, and a foul is going to be called there on the other Espinosa. That is number 25, Eladio. Jarvis Williams with it once again. He pulls up for three, and that one barely nips the front of the rim and down for the Coyotes. Corey Evans with it again on far side. Pulls up for three. He is not afraid of shooting it, and that went over the backboard, and possession will roll over to the Thunder.
Chase, I want to give a shout out real quick to our remote crew member today, Jason Warford. He's manning the remote office and helping us handle the broadcast today. He says that it looks great, and he also says that whatever he's doing is fantastic.
I'm sure everything he's doing is doing a great job.
So I just wanted to give him a shout out. He's helping us to make sure that everybody that's watching from wherever you are, you're getting the best quality feed you can get.
The fight for the rebound gathered up by the Thunder. A nice finish there at the rim for Washington. Evans with it. And a nice block there by number one. That was James once again as he goes all the way and gets the touch on the lay-in. 7:15 remaining here in the second quarter, as the lead for the Coyotes is just two. Nice pass, but off the fingertips of Espinosa. And he's going to get a foul called against him as well on the reach-in. Fast-paced game causes for a lot of foul calls. And the Coyotes have to be careful. Again, they only have three players on the bench. They can't get into a whole lot of trouble here.
You know, I don't know if this is the roster that they happen to have today or if this is the roster that they normally come with. But you're absolutely right. The depth is very apparent just looking at the benches. And if this is a war of attrition as it comes down right now, I mean, you're looking at a very close game, 39 all. I'd want to have the bench that the Thunder have, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Williams pulls up, and that one's short again. Looks like he just needs a little bit more on all of his shots. They've been slightly short, and a big swat there from James, rejecting right at the rim. Came flying in. I didn't even see him. Griffin drives in, floats it over everybody's arms, and it falls for him, pushing the lead back up to two for the Coyotes.
Down
Evans with it back to Griffin. Back to Evans. Great teamwork. The lone man couldn't defend either one of them. And the 30-second timeout is going to be called by the Thunder.
So you know right there, right now, early in the game, Chase, I'm gonna do a little pseudo-analysis, I guess, but it really looked like the Coyotes were trying to figure out what they wanted to do. They were constantly having to keep up the score. Once they took that lead, now it looks like the tide has turned and the Thunder are trying to figure out how to keep up with the Coyotes. But there's a long way to go. We still got 5:58 left in this quarter. And, you know, I think that you mentioned the bench length, and I think that could be a factor. I mean, these minor league games, they're always high-scoring affairs, and you need as many bodies as you can sometimes.
And it might come down to body count, but it also might come to how are they gelling out there on the floor. You have a deep bench for the Thunder, and they're using everybody on that bench, but how are they mingling with each other out there on the floor? Everybody's got to get in a different groove. Maybe somebody gets 5 minutes here or there, and a tangle down on the floor for the ball. Griffin with it, alley-oop. A little too far away. No finishing's going to go off.
I wanted that one to go down so badly. That would have been a nice little alley-oop there.
It would have been. It looks like we're going to have another timeout.
So, you know, what you were saying about the gelling on the floor, anybody who's played pickup ball knows if you go to play pickup ball with guys that you play with all the time and you play against a team of random dudes, you're going to have a good chance just because you know your teammates so well. You know?
You don't even have to have as good of talent, but you know how each other plays, and that has to be the advantage for the Coyotes right now that they have to exploit against this Thunder team.
You know, I hate to toss out a football analogy here to compare this to, but every year, like right now, they're going through the NFL mini camps and everything, and you hear about quarterbacks trying to get those reps in with their wide receivers. They want to know the behaviors. They want to learn each other. And that's one of the things that I think a lot of people may not realize about basketball. Knowing your players, knowing your teammates, you know what they're going to do in certain situations, so you can throw that no-look pass and it'll connect, and that's an advantage. So we don't know. The Coyotes, that may be the advantage they have. Maybe their talent, maybe they gel better as a team. It's worked so far in this one.
And I'll bring up Chris Paul. I remember an interview with him when he was having to adjust to Blake Griffin. He would throw alley-oops closer to the rim, and Blake was like, you have to stop throwing it that close. I need it further away from the rim. Just little things like that. That can help put your team and your players over the edge as that shot falls there for number 23 for the Thunder. That's Andrew Crawford. And alley-oop doesn't go again as that one looked like Chris Paul's alley-oop to Blake Griffin way away from the rim.
They got it figured out, though. We can't just slam Chris. You know,
no.
We may be in South Carolina, but our crew is from Winston-Salem, so, you know, Chris Paul is the hometown hero.
Exactly. Chris grew up literally three roads away from me. I say grew up. I was a little baby when he was growing up. He played football there a little bit with my high school coach. So my coach likes to – that's his claim to fame. As that three-point jumper is buried by number 23 Crawford again for the Thunder.
Yeah, Chris Paul does mention that a lot. I know recently there's been a lot of rumors about Chris Paul maybe going to the Spurs. And every interview, it's like, that might happen. And, of course, you know, Chris Paul did play near where Chase Vaden was born.
Exactly. Everybody knows where I'm from. But it would have been cool. I will say it would have been really cool to have Tim Duncan still with the Spurs, the young Wake Forest.
Yeah, Well, they never played together at Wake. But
it still would have been cool to have two Demon Deacons playing with each other.
Two of the most famous Demon Deacons. There's a couple of Demon Deacons, famous Demon Deacons that we were talking about this on the way down that still live in the area. Skip Brown is an All-American back in the late 70s. And then Rusty LaRue, who played famously with Michael Jordan in the NBA. Josh Howard.
And you can never forget Muggsy. You can't forget Muggsy.
Oh, I did. I did forget that.
How did you forget Muggsy?
And Muggsy, I know.
You can't forget anybody that was in the movie Space Jam.
I'm sorry, Muggsy. I do apologize. The next time I see you, I will apologize in person. But, you know, let's talk about this. We have a player here that played at Lotta, South Carolina, which is not far from where we're broadcasting. And Lotta, South Carolina has a famous Tar Heel alumni and NBA player, which is Raymond Felton, who helped bring a title to the Tar Heels back in 2005, I believe.
I believe it was back then, 2005, 2004, so somewhere around there. I was little then, but.
But Lotta, South Carolina, right up the road. Raymond did not go to play at one of the high-powered super schools, as you will, like Oak Hill or anything like that. He stayed and played at Lotta and went on to play for UNC, and he is from a high school right up the road. We have a player here who may have and probably did attend school with Raymond. What year did
It looks like his graduation year was 2001. That's Brandon Page. We actually have a few players here that played at Lotta, including Eric Crawford, number 4, and Deshaun Bethay. Well, we believe that Brandon Page was around. We'll have to ask him that later on before we keep feeding everyone false information.
We don't know.
Probably
somebody out there is watching and saying, What are you guys doing? They're just screaming at their phone or wherever they're watching this right now. How wrong we are. We got the basics right, I think. Really,
we've got a few connections, and we're not sure if it ties the knot.
General information about the game of basketball related to South Carolina. You guys fill in the rest. A lot of power on the inside play there.
Both these teams really trying to penetrate, but a lot of their points coming from deep, including that shot from Crawford. It's his second three ball in a row. He's knocked down. He's got 8 easy points, fairly easy points here in the second quarter. There's going to be a blocking foul called against number 21, B.J. Crawford, who attended in Mullins. That one ripped away right off the backboard, not even close to the goal, as Griffin brings it up the floor for the Coyotes. And a nice gliding finish there for number 21, Courget Cox. And that one's deflected away, and it's going to stay. It should stay here with the Thunder, but it won't. It will go over to the Coyotes. As Keane will check back in to the game for the Thunder. Bunn brings it up the floor. And the big three-pointer is off and rebounded. But a nice play by Bunn coming behind the play. Passes it back in, but no one is there.
You got to love that defensive awareness. And you got three Thunder players just standing there looking how they're going to kick off and run down the floor. And that guy just sneaks in behind him and swipes it away. Or attempted to swipe it away.
He did swipe it away. He just couldn't maintain possession as that one is patty-caked around. And Griffin will have it. Passes it up the floor to Espinosa. Keen almost got the block, but can't get the finish. And that one buried by number 10, Richardson. 2:40 remaining here in the second half. Scores tied up at 49. The big block there by James. That one rattles out and rebounded by Espinosa with 2:23 remaining. They're going to call a walk there against McKeithen. Nice. Richardson one-on-one with Griffin, kicks it back out. The three ball, too short. Coyotes come away with it. Bunn swings it over. Griffin got his man in the air, got the shot up and the foul. He'll go to the line for the end one opportunity. As the hack is credited to number 10, James Richardson of the Thunder. Checking in for the Thunder, number 34, Brandon Page, who we mentioned earlier, who attended LADA, along with number 6, that's Kendrick Whittington. As Griffin completes the and one opportunity. 1:47 remaining here in the second quarter. Whittington bangs his way in and knocks down the shot. Bunn splits the D, pulls back, can't get the shot to go, gets his own rebound. Nice pass in as Whittington gets the block. But I think they're going to call a foul on him. Espinosa brought the ball way back behind his head. It was swatted out by Whittington, but they say he got him on the wrist. Espinosa is off on the first. As the other Espinosa checks in for the Coyotes. The second one drops there for Mr. Espinosa. Whittington with it down low, wiggles his way in, gets his own rebound, and he knocks down his second attempt. Nice pass inside. Corey Evans with it, and he buries the jumper. Excuse me, that was not Evans, that was number 21, Corjay Cox. .7 remaining here in the second quarter. Coyotes still clinging to a slim lead, up 56-53 over the Thunder. As Richardson will step to the line. Little confusion over from the Thunder's coach and the ref. They have a little laugh, and Richardson will fork up two shots at the line. He's off on the first. Checking in for the Thunder, excuse me, for the Coyotes is number 4. That's Trey Day. He comes in for Bunn. Second free throw is off as well. Corjay swings it to the corner. Excuse me, to the side, and that one's buried by Griffin with 22 seconds remaining here in the second quarter. The lead has been extended to 6. 15 seconds remaining in the first half of this conference final. Three-point shot way off, and with 0.8 seconds remaining, the Thunder trying to have a miracle throw to end the half. Excuse me, the Coyotes. As that one falls short, the halftime score between the Coyotes and Thunder, 59-53. Stay with us here for second half action between these two squads as they chase the Northern Conference title. We'll be right back here on Netcast Sports.
Hey everybody, we just want to drop in real quick and thank you once again for joining us for the ECBL playoffs here in the Northern Conference action. Right after this game, we will have another great conference championship. The primetime players will take on the Carolina Crusaders. Winner of that game will play the winner of the game you're watching right now. We're at the half as the NC Coyotes lead the Carolina Thunder 59-53 here on netcastsports.com. You can watch this game not only live as you're doing now, but because you're technologically astute and you know how to do all these great things with your mobile, you can watch this on replay and on demand at netcastsports.com. And I'd like you to consider following the ECBL on Twitter as well, at ECBLHoops, as you can see on your screen. And if you've got some time after you do all that homework, you could try following us on Twitter as well, at Netcast Sports. But this is the moment right now. He's running laps. And what Chase likes to do in the break is exercise. He likes to do push-ups, jumping jacks. He runs through the crowd. He high-fives a lot of people, so he's doing that right now. And he'll be back momentarily. Also on the crew today is Louisville legend Colton Bishop. Colton may be joining us in just a few moments, but I promise that he is here. And our remote director today is Jason Warford.
One thing I want to announce, because I don't know if y'all understand.
There's some announcements by the PA.
We're going to have next the Carolina Crusaders and the primetime players at 7 p.m. Now, when I tell you that's going to be a good game, I saw them play last week. That's going to be a good game.
So Chase is back here in the broadcast booth.
Trying to catch my breath. All those
wind sprints and things that I saw you running down there.
I call them a skittle run. But
skittle run. Yeah, you know.
I had to focus my inner march on Lynch there
I've
for a second.
I've never seen anyone move as quickly as Chase did. As soon as the buzzer sounded, and he's a man on a mission. And I've seen the NFL Combine. I've seen the 40.
They got nothing on me.
Nothing.
Chris
nothing.
Johnson has nothing,
nothing
on me.
Nothing. You take whatever the fastest time was at the fastest NFL Combine, even those ones that are undocumented by Bo Jackson.
And you put one bag of Skittles at the end, and you say you have to beat this guy for it, I'll beat anybody. You put Usain Bolt. I might have to play a trick on him to
get him
force some hesitation.
What's that over
or
there?
Something. Yeah.
Run. So we got a tight game here, Chase. 59-53. Coyotes still in that lead. Got that short bench that we talked about in the first half. But it hasn't been a problem for them so far.
Not yet. And still not as much scoring as I thought there would be. But still close-knit game here between the both of them. It's still anybody's ball game.
Nobody's been really consistent from deep. We've had some deep shooting. I would say if I was going to pick out something that has worked consistently for either team, it's been the Coyotes' inside game. They do have a bit of a size advantage. It's not tremendous. But I would say that the Thunder don't seem to have as many pure post players as the Coyotes. So a lot of ceiling in the post for the Coyotes, a lot of getting to the hoop and just finishing off around the basket. So far, it's given them that six-point lead.
As you mentioned, both teams doing a great job being able to penetrate. Both teams aren't playing a whole lot of defense, especially on ball, and they're getting pretty easy penetration. Like you said, the biggest difference is Coyotes are finishing more at the rim.
There were a couple of like running from behind blocks, some defense, some steals in the open court. But yeah, a little bit for the Coyotes. I mean, I guess if there was an adjustment to make, maybe a little bit more spacing, but more of the same is probably what they're going to come back with for the Thunder. I think they're going to have to try to figure out how to keep the Coyote bigs out of the lane or try to figure out some kind of defensive scheme to deny the ball into the post.
And you've got to make sure you keep the ball away from Evans of the Coyotes. He's been a deep threat, finishing all over the floor, finishing at the rim in many kind of ways, and a big-time rebounder for them as well.
Both teams back out on the floor. We got about 3.5 left here on the clock until the end of the half. So both teams out here warming up, trying to figure out what they're going to do. You can see we're going to give a little juxtaposition here. We can see the guys right now on your screen for the Coyotes. That is pretty much their team in the white playing home. And then we're going to just quickly jump over to the other side of the court where the Thunder are. And you can see there's just a lot more players for the Thunder.
And we'll really see if that starts to play. A lot of these, both these teams really playing run and gun offensive games. Nobody really settling down too much in the half court. So we'll see if even conditioning comes into play, especially against the Coyotes.
It's going to be interesting. And I want everybody who's out there watching right now, now, please bear in mind, whoever comes out of this game is going to have to play the winner of the next game. So you should be trying to check out those matchups. The Coyotes have been able to use their size. But next game, two new teams. Winner of that is the Southern Conference. They're going to play the winner of this one for the championship. And, you know, I'm a fan of the game. I like to see those matchups. I haven't seen I have not seen the Thunder play earlier. I've seen the Coyotes play earlier this year, but not the Thunder. So this is my first chance of seeing them. Now, next game, and I don't want to pump up the next game when we have a current game going on too much, but the primetime players have a good history. They're the reigning ECBL champions. Undefeated this season, if I'm correct.
You're correct. Yeah. You're correct. 14-0 so far.
14-0. They normally compete in the national basketball tournament, the tournament called the tournament.
The tournament.
Yeah, the TBT.
You know if it has a the.
Yeah, the basketball tournament.
It's legit.
Had a $1 million prize and a $2 million prize. The primetime players made it very deep in that tournament a year or so ago. To where I think they were either in the Final Four or the Final Two. They were on television. You know, you had to make it to that final weekend to play on ESPN, and they did. So that's the caliber of team we're talking about with the primetime players. But all of these teams, you know, in order for them to be in the playoffs in advance, they've already advanced through the first round. You know, they had to bring a little something to get here. So we got about a minute to go. We'll be going to step away for just a moment. We'll be back for the second half right after this.
Welcome back here to Netcast Sports. We are live here from Hartsville, South Carolina. Not sure if we're in the heart of South Carolina. We might be. But nonetheless, we've got a basketball game going on between the Coyotes and the Thunder. The Northern Conference Final in the East CBL. Coyotes up 59-53 right now. Close matchup, and as we talked about earlier, down low penetration has been a big key for the Coyotes and a stop there for the Thunder as it swings out. And the three ball there from number 23 for the Thunder, Andrew Crawford, starting off here in the second half exactly how he finished the first, hot from three. as that one rattled home again from Espinosa. That's number 11. That's Robert Espinosa. That will swing down to Williams. He drives the lane off the back of the iron. Rolled around, and Evans comes away with it for the Coyotes. A foul is going to be called there. A couple people hit the floor.
You know, Chase, we spent all that time at halftime talking about the inside game, and I hope everybody's all right here. Looks like we got some guys down. Everybody's shaking up. But right away, 2-3 balls coming out of the half.
Especially from the Thunder. Well, both teams have hit, but you could see there on the very first possession, big man number 50 for the Coyotes, Raymond McKeithen, went straight to the cup, couldn't get it to go. But you could tell the Coyotes are probably going to try to penetrate a lot down inside. A couple players shook up there for both squads. It looks like Evans and his left ankle a little bit. Couldn't get an eye on. Looked like Devontae Washington for the Thunder as the Thunder grab it. Richardson goes inside. I tell you what, it's the third time it's happened. He gets up and just hangs in the air. He just floats there for about 5 more seconds. Lets everybody else who's trying to block a shot and fall back to the ground. It knocks it down as Griffin's going to go to the line here for 2 shots. The foul's going to be called. Excuse me. It's going to be a side out. It looked like a foul was called on Jarvis Williams of the Thunder. Al Horford with the shot. Excuse me. That was the big man, Raymond McKeithen. He's wearing both those arm sleeves just like Al Horford. And he knocks the 3 down just like him. A nice shot there for the Thunder as Bunn splits the D, loses it. He's going to stay here with them.
Fast and furious scoring here in the second half already.
I think they heard us complaining about the low scoring for as far as minor league basketball. So, you know what? I'm going to go here and just start firing away.
That's right. They said, we'll show you guys. We're offensively prowessed.
Some complaining going on from the Coyotes bench. As it looked like it went out of bounds off of the Coyotes. They awarded them the ball because it looked like he was fouled from behind. But I've always been one of those guys, if you're going to call a foul, give them a foul. If you're going to just call out of bounds, call it on who it's out on. But don't give them the ball because there was a foul and don't not call the foul. Call it what it is. Griffin with it at the top. Working around the defense. That's off his foot. Referee looks a little confused. Inverted whistle is what they claim, even though it looked like it went off of Bunn's foot. They're going to say it was kicked by the Thunder. It's going to stay with the Coyotes. Bunn with it. Glides around, finds a gap, gets it to Evans. He's carried, and he knocks it down. He's going to go to the line for an old-fashioned three-point play. And the foul is going to be going against number 6, Kendrick Whittington, as the lead has gained 2-7 for the Coyotes, and Evan will try to push it to 8.
If I'm not mistaken, I believe he's an all-star selection.
That's exactly what the MC is reminding us of right now.
I only know that because on the media list, we got the all-star list yesterday. I'm pretty sure he's on there.
And it's pretty clear that it's not a mistake. He's been showing out all game for the Coyotes, really holding them in with the lead as that one's knocked down by number one, Trey James. As Bun with it, pulls up for three. Looked like he almost got stepped on the closeout, but nonetheless knocks down the three-point shot. Three ball is off and brought down by Evans.
If the Coyotes keep shooting like this, Chase, they're not going to have to worry about their bench swing.
Exactly. Some great penetration there, and looks like that one's going to go against. Looked like they called it against Jarvis Williams. Didn't even look like he was near the play, but that's who the referee is going to call the foul on. As Evans knocks down the first. Second rattles out as Williams brings it up the floor for the Thunder. Gliding up, the foul's going to be called. And that's going to go. They do play continuation here in the minor league. So that one goes for Williams. He'll go to the line for an and one opportunity. And that one falls, cutting his team's deficit to just seven. 8:50 remaining here in the third. Bun with control. They waved off the shot. They waved off the shot. It didn't look like he put the ball back down on the floor. He made the shot, but they're going to say no. Foul's going to be called against number 23 for the Thunder. As the Coyotes stay with it, Bun's going straight to the cup again, kicks it back out, and that one off the fingertips of McKeithen. Williams brings it up. And that one rejected by McKeithen. Richardson pulls up. That one rattles out. Whittington comes in. Gets the rebound, and a foul is going to be called on the big man, McKeithen.
Nice rebound coming over the top there. Perfect timing, just snatching it out of the bigger player's grasp.
We talked about that on the way down here. You can be as tall as you want to be, and not that Whittington is small at all. He's a tall man. But his timing and gliding across the court.
Just so people don't think we're
rebound.
Just so people don't think we're that prescient. We were talking about it in general. We were not talking about
right.
That play.
Right. And what we're saying is every single play here is scripted.
No. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain.
Is that three ball unscripted? Does not go in. Trying to get the foul call was Espinosa. But the referees say no deal as the Thunder are off and running. And that one knocked down by number 20, Alex Brown, as the lead is trimmed to four.
Coyotes came out hot, and Thunder have responded.
Bun trying to do a lot by himself as that one's off the foot of Richardson. Coyotes are going to have to get a lot of their teammates involved. Bun is holding on to the ball a little bit more. I know when I hold on to the ball a little bit too long in 2K, my teammate grade goes down. So his teammate grade's going down a little bit right now.
This
but
is just like that.
As Williams loses it, they're going to call a foul. They're going to give it to number 35, Corey Evans. It will stay on this end with the Thunder. Three ball, no good. And ripping the rebound away and finally getting the finish is number one, Trey James. A great play there, sticking with it and getting the finish.
Unstoppable rebounding machine.
Evans wanted that, didn't get the foul call. quick three put up and rattled in, and just like that, the Thunder have come back and taken the lead.
Get a timeout. I'm not kidding. Oh, now they're saying no timeout.
They said no timeout.
They thought they wanted a timeout. I suggest they take a timeout.
It would make a lot of sense.
PA announcer is right. We have a game.
75-74. Evans, the man of glory for the Coyotes, brings it up the floor as he's trapped. Didn't see Williams around as he gets it down low to McKeithen. He backs his way in. For some reason, doesn't get a foul call. He threw it out of bounds, but once again, they give it back to the Coyotes. I highly disagree with that kind of call. If you're going to call a foul, call a foul.
Call a foul. But I will say this. There was an adjustment in the half, and they double-teamed down there in the post. They were not doing that in the first half.
Exactly. Great play there by the Thunder, and that's helped them obviously get back to this ball game and take the lead. As that one goes off, referees haven't decided. Now they have. It's going to go over to the Thunder.
Defensive intensity has ratcheted up in the last couple of minutes.
And that's saying a lot. Both teams really wanting this, wanting to get a crack at whoever will win the Southern Division as Evans gets it, gets his defender on his back,
and gets time.
The shot to go. You always want to get that defender on your back, be able to feel exactly where he is, and that's exactly what Evans did. Smart play, drawing the foul, and having the balance and control to finish at the hoop.
Finishing with contact, underrated skill for a lot of players, no matter what your position. Usually people focus on the big men being able to finish through contact, but no matter where you play on the floor, that's a skill that will come into play at some point.
Exactly.
Oh, that's a light touch call right there.
A little different than what we've seen, but nonetheless, Williams will go to the line. Just over 6 minutes remaining here in the third quarter as that one falls. And that one falls out. Bunn with it. One on one.
That's some good defensive positioning. No switch out there on the outside.
Great double team even on the outside. Great play there by the Thunder and a smart trap. Great team play there by the Thunder and finishing off with the hoop is number 20, Alex Brown. Great play overall. Great defense. Great vision to see the man in the corner.
Look at this. Somebody, the Thunder got the memo. Double team the big man in the post. Double team the big man whenever he gets the ball.
Exactly. Just a little over aggressive there for the Thunder. And we're going to take a media timeout. We appreciate that once again. I'm still not used to that.
Yeah, we're the ECBL is a pro organization, Chase, and we really appreciate them. We're going to take this media timeout to fawn over them. But once again, if you like what you're seeing today and you like the ECBL and you're going through withdrawals right now out there because the NBA Finals wrapped up early, maybe you thought it was going to go seven games and you were wrong, you could be happy to know that this is not the last day of ECBL action. The championship is coming up, but to be between the winners of these two games today, and then on July 1st, ladies and gentlemen, July 1st, we will have the ECBL All-Star Game broadcast here on Netcast Sports, so you can check out a couple of the guys you're seeing today and a whole lot of other talented guys that have had fantastic seasons. So July 1st, the ECBL All-Star Game coming to you from Winston-Salem, North Carolina. So that would be a hometown broadcast for us. We're wrapping up the media timeout. I'm going to go kick this back over to Chase.
Appreciate the info, Marcus. 5:28 remaining here in the third quarter. A small one-point lead being held by the Thunder. They fought back. But in just a shot or two, The lead can be taken away from them by Robert Espinosa as he is at the line for the Coyotes. As the first one rattles out, and he'll have another opportunity to tie this game up.
I don't know about you, Chase, but I love a back-and-forth game. And that's exactly what we've got on tap for today, and I don't see this changing anytime soon. Both teams have gone on a little bit of a run here and there, but neither team has been able to establish a long-term stranglehold on this game.
Exactly, and one thing that can separate these two, which didn't happen just a second ago, is free throws. In a close game like this, every point is going to count, especially in such a high-scoring affair. As Bung glides in, and a great defensive play there
back to
by
back.
Jarvis Williams, maintaining his eyes there on the ball.
We had back-to-back solid defensive plays there.
As that one's off by Espinosa, didn't even hit the backboard, as that one's tapped out by the other Espinosa, and it will go back over to the Thunder. Williams one-on-one with Griffin as the screen's there. Somehow that pass got through but couldn't get the finish, and the board is brought down for the Coyotes. Pass back out to Griffin. He waits for the screen. He's double-teamed off of it. Bunn working his man, finds a big gap and finishes at the cup. A great play there, finishing high off the glass.
A little Kyrie Irving-esque there on the finish.
Just a tad, a nice touch there from Bunt. The off-balance three is no good and brought down there by Eladio Espinosa, number 25. Jorge Cox with it, glides in, back to Espinosa. He tries to get it off the glass, can't get it to go, has arms all around him, goes up and draws the foul. Couldn't fight amongst the trees to get the hoop in the harm, but gets the harm. So he'll go to the line for two. That one rounds out. That's three straight misses at the free throw line as wholesale changes come in for the Thunder, including Keene, along with Washington and Page. Espinosa off on the second as well. That one rebounded and a save, but back to the other team, as Keene's going to get called for the foul, bumping into Griffin from behind. That pass earlier almost thrown away by Page, chased down by Keene, but he couldn't get it back into his team. It's five straight misses at the line for the Coyotes.
You're just leaving points out there when you do that.
Six straight. The free throw misses are countering the sloppy play from the Thunder here in the past couple minutes. And we're still tight-knit here, just a one-point game. Keene finds a small gap, glides in.
Oh, that was nice. He had a little misdirection, saw the gap, went for it.
Number 11. Gets blown by. Oh, looked like a goaltending.
It did look like it was in the cylinder. No call, I guess.
No call, but Coyotes lead now. Excuse me, 80-79 with the Thunder in the lead.
You know, one thing is interesting. A lot of times at minor league, you see very animated head coaches, and our coaches are into the game and coaching, but I wouldn't say they're overly animated in the sense that they don't have to be controlled and
exactly.
Reined in.
Right.
There's something to be said for just being a basketball mind and coaching from the sideline.
See, I don't think I could ever make a coach. If I ever have kids, I'm going to have a hard time trying to stay calm on the sidelines. I don't think I'm going to be one of those that would be cool, calm, and collected.
Duly noted for all the future coaches that you may have to encounter.
I may change my name if I do become a coach.
You know, we're talking about the free throw disparity, and the Thunder just dropped two in, extending their lead to three. Right now, the biggest story, as much as I hate to say it, of this quarter has been the free throw shooting of the Coyotes, or lack thereof.
Missing six straight so far. And that one blocked at the rim as Bunn brings it up the floor. Robert Espinosa gets it stripped away by Keane. He throws up something, and he ends up with the Thunder.
Yeah, I'm not sure where he was going. Maybe it just slipped out of his hand. Good closeout, but he just drained it right in his face.
Big shot there by Deshaun Bethea.
All right, so the question is, Chase, is this lead now that the Thunder have built due to fatigue from the short bench of Coyotes?
I'm not sure if it's even fatigue. The free throws might even be fatigue as well.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I mean, I hadn't even thought of that. But you're right.
You know, when you get tired or you start feeling in your legs, you don't bend nearly as much as what you're used to at the line. As they do make a change, here they bring in the big man, once again, number 50, Raymond McKeithen, who went out for a few minutes. He's back in. But they want it again. That one dramatically short, and rebounded back into McKeithen.
He keeps it.
Great play there to fight through the swipes.
That's an earned bucket right there, yeah.
Keane wants it. Oh. And that's going to be a goaltending off the backboard first.
A goaltending call for sure.
Great effort there by Keane. Not sure if the basket would have gone if it hadn't been goaltending.
Yeah, that's
but nonetheless.
Yeah.
Great play there from fighting all the way back down.
You're really taking a risk when you try to swipe it off the backboard like that. You're not guaranteed that.
You're not guaranteed the LeBron James moment.
Yeah. Well, I have to say, not many of us are.
As Keane has it once again for the Thunder, thought about pulling it up, looking for an open man, gets it to Brown, and his shot doesn't go either, as that one is lost out of bounds.
I don't want to read too much into this, but I do feel like the Coyotes' fatigue may be a factor, even going after loose balls and things like that. They just seem a little lethargic. They're going to have to find a well of energy here and try to finish out. You know, this is just the third.
But you never know. I mean, no lead is safe here, but they've got to make an effort to at least show the Thunder that they're not done fighting. 55 seconds remaining here. Shots up, and that one falls.
Did that bank? I couldn't tell.
It was an off angle. I couldn't tell if it banked either. But nonetheless, the shot falls for Corjay Cox.
That was a much-needed three.
Keane with it one-on-one. You haven't seen a lot of touchy fouls called, and that was one of them. That one's going to go against number 21, Corjay Cox.
Yeah.
Of the Coyotes. And in the bonus, they're going to send Keane to the line.
You know, one thing about Keane, I've noticed his ability to draw the foul right in driving in the lane could be a factor. That's twice now he's been able to do that. And he's a good free throw shooter, at least he has been today.
Anything can be better than what the Coyotes have done missing.
Yeah.
Everything here in the second half.
At least when it comes to free throw, they're like the monster, or somebody has stolen their mojo on the free throw line here.
Yeah, it looks like we jinxed Keane on that last one.
Open shot! Open shot!
PA announcer claiming open shot. Doesn't matter. We haven't seen a lot of open jumpers knocked down. And that one, a slight hand in the face.
The three ball.
For McKeithen.
The three ball is just the Coyotes' savior right now.
As they've dug their way back into this game. Just a one-point lead now. 5 seconds remaining here. Thunder got one more shot. And that one's off. Rebounded by McKeithen. And we're going to have one final quarter to settle it all between these two teams for the Northern Conference Championship here in the ECBL. The Eastern Conference Basketball League. East Coast Basketball League. Final quarter begins here in the Northern Conference Championship. Williams with it for the Thunder. Three ball swishes the net, but didn't go through it. As the Coyotes have it, losing it. A foul's going to be called on Keem.
Not a lot of time in the break there for the for either team to come up with an adjustment, but big story, missed free throws in that third quarter, negated somewhat by the Coyotes' ability to hit that deep ball late in the third. And let's see what they go. Right back inside, no double team.
It was a delayed double team. As
didn't materialize fast enough.
But nonetheless, it did work. Shot didn't go. Williams steps right into the lane. Floater doesn't go. A nice rebound and finish down low by Kendrick Whittington. Bunn with it. Finds the hole, back out to McKeith and spins it back to Bunn. His three doesn't fall. And the Thunder back in possession. Tried to find a gap, and that one's going to go off the Coyotes. Nice pass inside. That one ripped away from behind by Evans. Courget Cox glides in off the glass, and a foul's going to be called there, sending him to the line. Home for Cox.
That breaks the streak, doesn't it?
I believe it does. I think the streak was around six straight misses.
It's not a streak they wanted to keep going.
Exactly. And the broadcaster announcer jinx again as that one falls. Out. That one slipped out of his hand. He regains possession in the corner. That one doesn't fall. A nice box out there from Evans. Bunn finds his man in the corner. That one no good and into the hands of James. The floating king, number 10, James Richardson. Every single bucket he's had, he's floated up in the air. Nice double team, but Evans gets through it, and they're going to call double dribble. Double dribble call there against Evans. It looked like the Thunder had their hands on it, so I don't know how they called the double dribble. But nonetheless, the referee makes his call, and that's what's going to happen. That's going to be a foul called against Evans as he bumped into Whittington. And Evans not happy with the call at all. That floater doesn't go as it's rebounded, and a foul is going to be called. Pretty much bad, wrong place, wrong time is pretty much what's going to be called against James there, as he's credited with the foul.
I would say it's a little bit of a bailout call. It was a correct call, but looked like he didn't know where he was going to go with the ball and just happened to be fortunate enough to come down. A player was in the wrong place.
Exactly. The Coyotes have it, trailing by 4 to the Thunder here in the Northern Conference Final. Deep three. That was off the front of the rim and rebounded by Williams. Tries to glide in back to Whittington. He goes, and that's going to be a charge called against Whittington. A great play there by McKeithen to stay. Excuse me. Now they have changed the call to a block. Whittington's basket will count. And the foul's going to be going against McKeithen.
So that's going to be an and one now, I think. Is that the correct?
Yes.
Yeah, it looks like they've added it to the scoreboard. We're at 9:05, I think.
It looked to me like a great play by McKeithen with no half circle down below the rim. But it looks like that's what they're pretty much why they're calling it. Looked like his foot would have been in the imaginary no fly zone
that,
down there.
That charge block call is always tough. I think they got that one right. And it's hard, and it's a bang bang play in real time. It felt right at the time. 23
blue. At time. Coach is arguing about something. But going to the line, I believe, is actually what they were arguing about. Number 21, Corjay Cox. As the free throw woes continue for the Coyotes as they trail by 7 and need all the points they can get with 9 minutes remaining here in this conference final. As that one drops, cutting the deficit to 6.
They basically, I believe, have left 9 points at the free throw line in this second half at least. That's my unofficial count.
Definitely shooting under 50%, and that's never good at the free throw line.
No.
If you're shooting DeAndre Jordan numbers or less from the free throw line, it's not going to help you in a tight, close game like this. And that's going to stay on this end with the Thunder. So they're going to call it out on Espinosa. And that pass swatted down by Bunn as he takes it to the rim. He's had a nice touch at the glass, and he gets that one to fall. The lead just 4 for the Thunder. Great play there using the screen. Floated in to draw the foul. And that will send number 10, Richardson, to the line for 2 shots.
2 advantages that we've talked about all game. One being the bench of the Thunder. The second being their ability to get to the free throw line and actually convert. Have been the difference, I would say. I would say Coyotes are lucky to only be down 4, as poorly as they've shot at the free throw line in the second half.
Free throw line being a big factor, and like you mentioned earlier, the 3-point shot is really the only thing that's kept the Coyotes even close.
Yeah, they've had a couple of fast breaks that have helped, but they need something consistent, and really they've got to convert if they get to the line.
A dangerous play. That one's called a charge.
Broke his neck.
The PA announcer doesn't lie. Dangerous play. Corey Evans glides in. Gets tabletopped. And he is not happy with that whatsoever.
Yeah, I mean, the danger to the player doesn't really have any impact on whether it was a foul or
right.
not. I mean, as far as, you know, unless you're getting clotheslined, clearly that would.
Exactly. It was just a dangerous play because he had gotten so high up in the air. I believe it was the correct call. He was out of control coming in, which is exactly why it was a dangerous play. He was out of control.
He did a good job.
Fell over. Yeah.
He did a good job at the perimeter, splitting the defense. Just kind of out of control. Defense adjusted behind the primary defender.
And two quick jabs by the referee calling two charges. I believe that's the only kind of punches that Conor McGregor is going to land in a couple weeks anyway.
I wouldn't call these refs charge happy, but it does seem like we've had a sudden proliferation of them in the past few minutes.
And I think that goes towards there's a lot more one-on-one happening right now.
Yep.
Closer towards the rim. Whittington goes in. Can't get that one to go. As Espinosa gathers up the rebound, and Griffin will bring it up the floor for the Coyotes. Guarded closely by Keene. Steps back for that three. That one doesn't go. As there's only Thunder up. Great pass! What a pass down to Keene. Splitting three defenders.
I gotta take a moment of silence. That was a deadly pass, and I don't know who it killed, but it killed somebody somewhere because that was just nasty. He just threaded the needle, and it was at ankle height. Somehow, Keene was able to grab it. It was an Odell Beckham-like.
He threw it so low, and it just perfect bounce. Just a beautiful pass.
Yeah, that was a thing of beauty right there. Props. Pass was nice. The catch was nice. Touchdown. Odell Beckham would be proud. Do your end zone dance. We got a timeout on the floor, though.
Timeout up on the floor, and the Thunder up three field goals. It might be our last football reference of this game. Stay tuned.
That's right. We try to work in as many sports as we can in every broadcast.
You never know if the next game starts out 15-0, we might have to go 15-love. Throw in a tennis reference.
Let's keep it in the bag. We want people to tune in and see what we're going to pull out.
That's the thing. You don't know what we're going to throw at you next. So Bunn throws it down low.
They're
back
really
out.
Using that double team down there effectively.
They're making sure what we had seen, that inside penetration, does not happen here. And a block there. They are swarming him.
Oh, triple team.
Hop step, Ray's one, off. Two, Ray's and a glide. Great play there.
Here's the thing. That entry pass from the guard on that end is great by the Coyotes, but they're just collapsing on him in the defense, and he's got to kick it back out, and it looks like they're not wanting to do that.
You can see Williams. Griffin's got to be ready to shoot that shot when he gets the ball back. That's the only thing that's been keeping him in the game. Not necessarily that it's a smart shot, but if he's going to have an open shot, it's what he's going to have to do.
This is a dangerous spot in the game for the Coyotes. I mean, we've been talking about them at the free throw line here, and, you know, 6.5 to go.
Down 11?
Down 11, yeah. I mean, this is an up-and-down game, and it can get away from them in a hurry. You're in danger territory right here. They need a couple of buckets, and that's not helping.
They've missed just as many free throws as they are down in points. And that's something you look at as a coach during and after the game. You say that's where this game we lost control. But there is still time for them to fight back as Keene glides in. That one tipped out. Griffin off and running with Keene behind him. Throws it up. Wanted some contact. Didn't get it as Keene gathers it up.
They're just quicker to the ball right now, too. That fatigue could be the factor. We talked about it earlier. Now they're wanting to slow it down a little.
I'm trying to milk some of this clock. And if you guys are wondering, there are shot clocks here during this game. You might be able to see them as the shot clocks are underneath this top level. As that one's blocked and pinned against the backboard. They're going to actually call a foul there on Williams against Espinosa on the reach in. A timeout has been called by the Thunder. We'll set it up for you. 5:34 remaining here in the fourth quarter. Coyotes trailing by 11, 102-91 against the Thunder.
Hey, let's get a little feedback from Colton. Colton, we're trying to get his attention. We're going to bring in a guy here. Hey. All right, we're going to bring in Colton Bishop here, our cameraman for the day, but professional analyst for the moment. Colton is actually playing. He's a college basketball player. He's actually working with us in our mini broadcast. Colton, you're the coach of the Coyotes here. What do you think? We're down by 11.
It's the playoffs, so you guys just got to come out this last 5 minutes and play as hard as you can. Be active. Try to get something going toward the rim. Get the clock to stop a little bit, get some free throws, and then near the end of the game, you know, try and get some threes to knock down. So,
see, that's the kind of expert analysis that you have been missing this entire game, and you had to wait until 5:34 left to get it.
I tried to get on earlier, but, you know.
I know. We were having to fight you off, and you were telling us, you're wrong. What you guys are saying is completely off base.
I like doing the camera, though. It's fun.
Yeah,
so.
You're exceptional. The people at home are glad you're not moving it around.
I only think I lost the ball once or twice, but, you know, it's a little down from my past game. So.
So a level set here, 5:23 left to go, 102-92. Deep outside shot is good.
That's just a tough shot right there. You can't do too much about that.
Yeah, right now the free throws are killing the Coyotes, and the three ball is falling. Yeah. And the Thunder just seem to have – they got that deeper bench, and they're more active. So,
I think it ended up being the bench just started to wind down a little bit because you only got three subs over there. And I think the Thunder have six or seven players on their bench. So
yeah, it's a factor.
It gets to you by the end of the game.
Size on the Coyote side, but they just can't keep up with all that extra energy on the bench. So anyway, Colton, we really appreciate you jumping in.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll see you in the next game.
Definitely.
We'll see the primetime players. Once again, that's Colton Bishop. Yep. You can see Colton playing this year at Piedmont International University, playing the point guard and bringing some of that astute basketball IQ. And we'll bring Chase back in here.
The less smarter Chase.
The less smarter Chase. There's a smarter Chase. I guess, were you trying to prove the point?
No, I'm definitely the brains of this operation. We've been getting hand signals from Colton a little while.
Oh,
that's what that was.
I thought that was demonstrative.
He's been over here telling me I've been wrong.
I'm going to turn this back over to you with 4:25 left to play. I'm going to step back out of the way and let you take the reins of the broadcast once again, much, I'm sure, to the pleasure of the people at home. So.
And we've got 4:25 remaining here. Once again, the Coyotes at the line. They've got to convert, and that one falls. The lead still double digits. It's 10 for the Thunder as they keep making substitutions, making sure they can sprint up and down the floor when they need to. Two for two there for Griffin as pressure is immediate. Keane one-on-one with the big man. That one doesn't go. McKeithen gets it.
Uh-oh. That is.
Didn't get the slam.
Almost blew it. There's a lot of time left now. They're right in there with him.
And a timeout called. Coach of the Thunder doesn't like what's going on. 7-point lead, 3:57. Plenty of time.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, one thing I'd like to point out is, I don't know if we were able to catch this, but the Coyote coaches are trying to get their team ramped. They're trying to get them hyped up and make them say, hey, this is not over, guys. You got 4 minutes left. You know, it's time to ball out. Colton was saying this in the break or just earlier when he was on the broadcast. You know, it's the playoffs. Pull out all the stops. You're only down 7.
How bad do you want it?
How bad do you want it?
This is when you have to dig deep.
You want to get to that championship.
This is one title, and you want the shot at the big one coming up soon.
Ooh, full court pickup here.
They're picking up full court.
And the referee's pretty much saying, no, you're not allowed to do that, and giving a quick foul to Griffin. The penalty has been enforced, and we're going to have Williams at the line for two shots. I'd like to remind you to stay with us, not only to complete this game, but coming up around 7 o'clock, which is right now. So coming up very shortly after the conclusion of this game, we'll have the next one against the Carolina Crusaders and the Primetime Players. They'll be battling out for the Southern Conference title as the Thunder coming in clutch at the line.
Good job by the by Thunder coming up to make him pick up that ball, not letting them run any more time off the clock or keep any time, save time for themselves.
And I'll say this, there were four Thunder players down low to get that rebound, even though it squirted out a little further from where they were. There were four players for the Coyotes around the three-point line. They're right. Not even down low trying to get a rebound. You've got to get, if your initial shot doesn't go, you have to get boards on the offensive end right now.
There's just no denying it. The Thunder have the fresher legs at this point in the game.
And you look at the bench for the Coyotes, they're tired. The men on the floor right now, they're tired. But even though there's still 3:18 left, you have to dig deep. This is where champions are made of. And this time, it's not in the first quarter. It's late in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, right now, down by 8. Down by 10, actually, I think.
Those 8s on the board threw you off.
Yeah, it's all 8s all across the board. Oh, that's a foul on the outside.
And that shot falls for Bon. He hadn't been able to knock down the 3 as of late. He wishes that one would have counted.
I hate to say it, but putting the Coyotes on the line is a, from a probability standpoint, percentages right now is a smart move.
As we'll knock on our non-wooden table.
That's right. We're controlling the ability to hit free throws from up here.
One of those scripted things we weren't talking about earlier is McKeithen rattles in the second.
That cuts it to 8. I mean, they're in this 3 minutes.
Stranger things have happened.
For the Thunder, you got to wonder at what point. I mean, with this shot clock, they can't take too much air out of the ball, but, you know, they just want to basically make the right play every time down at this point.
McKeithen's shot doesn't fall, but the Thunder get the rebound once again. It was off a couple Coyote hands.
Big rebound.
And getting the extra shot clock. Keane holding on to it, milking the clock a little bit, and gets the reverse lay-in to go.
That is a huge timely play by Keane there.
Using up almost 2 full shot clocks. Worked up about 40 seconds.
I'm going to have a banner emergency.
And that one doesn't go. Another rebound for the Coyotes. Bunn gets rid of it. And that one finally drops. No foul called. Looks like we got an injured player on the ground. That's Corjay Cox. As he was hitting the face with no call, he got the shot to go, though. He still gets up off the ground. Can't tell. He's holding his nose. Can't tell if he's bleeding or not. Obviously, we hope he is all right.
I had a little banner emergency. Our fans are getting so excited here. We had to knock the banner off in front of our broadcast booth here, high in the rafters.
So he makes the free throw. This is a 9-point gap.
And it looked like that was, I did not see anything happen. I saw.
Was that a technical foul?
It looked like a technical free throw. Which is odd considering it looked like a Coyote player was fouled, but I think that's what happened. They weren't happy.
Situation with some moisture or hopefully not blood or anything on the floor.
That's where Corjay Cox made his way to the ground.
We've got the official towel being broken out here.
As long as nobody's stomping on a terrible towel, it's
Keen,
okay.
Keen springing to action. I don't know how that goes in the stat book. He had the brilliant catch earlier. He had the nice little drive in reverse. He's had some good plays now. He's kept the game going with his towel action.
We can call that a swipe?
Swipe. I guess you add that to the stat book. One swipe. Coyotes in sort of in desperation times here.
Do it again. You can't get the points for that. Do it again.
Tells him do that breakaway dunk. He says, do it in the game. You don't get points for that. Do it in the game. The PA announcer giving them instructions on what to do and not do in the game.
Well, what to do? That was a smart timeout call there by the Thunder as they were trapped.
Yeah, absolutely.
But the time is dwindling for the Coyotes to make this final move. They're down 9 with a minute 50 remaining here in the ball game.
Yeah, if you're the Thunder, you have to feel really good about where you are right now at this point in the game. 150. They've got energy. They got the lead. The free throws are falling. The clock is on their side. The Coyotes, they're not just going to go away. So, a couple of defensive stops, a couple of big buckets, and that's not what they wanted, I don't believe.
It's a smart play by Richardson. He knew Griffin was close. He's had good control, and he puts himself on the line for 2 shots.
You can see the other teams coming into the gym. They're all ready to play. Like you said, they're all lined up.
They're ready to go. Their game was supposed to start at 7.
Yeah, I assume that they're going to get some warm-up time.
You sure hope so. You never want a conference championship to start off with nobody loose or getting up any shots, or else that first quarter will be a warm-up quarter. 3-point shot and a foul.
Is that going to be a 3?
It looks like it is. The foul's going to go against Williams and put Griffin on the line.
Could not have been a better play for the Coyotes right here. Who went clock stopped and shooting 3.
You can cut it to 6 right here if you knock them all down. And Griffin has been a key free throw shooter here in the game.
Oh, that tantalizingly close there.
Rattling all the way around and out. Make sure the second one falls, and he'll try to knock this one down to cut the lead to 7 in a 3-possession ball game.
They needed those. They needed those. They would have liked to have 3, but they needed something.
Nice tight defense there by Griffin on Williams. They're going to call a block there on Griffin. Smart play by Williams. Looked like he got an elbow high, but the blocking call is going to go against Griffin. And the bonus, Williams would go to the line, shooting as many free throws as the number on his jersey. 2. He's off on the first.
They don't want to go cold right now, shooting free throws. They want to just finish them off if they can.
8-point lead. Coyotes with it. Tries to get inside. Lost it. Tried to get it to Espinosa. He saves it. But to Keen. And that pass tipped away by Griffin, saving a bucket. But it will stay on this end with the Thunder with 22 seconds remaining on their shot clock.
It was almost a brilliant play, but I would be a little concerned as a coach about those home run plays with just over a minute to play. You know, you want to just basically keep your cool. Like, you know, it's always nice to run out the clock with a dunk or something like that, but there's still enough time here
a lot of things can go wrong, and the most that you can control, in essence, the better it'll be.
So like you were saying, we have another game coming up after this. You can go to netcastsports.com and see the link on our main page for that 7 o'clock game, which clearly is not going to be starting at 7 o'clock. But we imagine there'll be we'll update on our Twitter at netcastsports about the tip time for that game. I imagine there'll be a bit of warm-up.
Bunn puts up the last second three. Gets that one to go. The lead is 6. With a minute left, Keene has it. And the foul's going to be called on Bunn, even though he actually didn't touch him.
It's a two-possession game. And with a shot clock, with this 24-second shot clock.
The free throws, missing free throws was a big factor for the Coyotes. And now the Thunder have to show that they can knock theirs down to close this game out. 54 seconds remaining up on the big board.
Big shot there by Keene.
Pushing that back to a 3-possession game and a 7-point lead.
You mentioned earlier that he bears some resemblance to Klay Thompson. He's been that consistent here in this second half.
Looks like he's got the free throw form as well as him. 8-point lead down to 6 with a quick bucket there by Griffin as Williams is fouled. And it looks like this is the game we are going to play here in the last 48 seconds. It's a little game I like to call who can make the free throw.
Yeah. So far it's gone the Thunder's way. We'll see if that holds out.
That shot is short. Opening up the door for the Coyotes.
That tightens it up.
And that one spins out. Griffin with it again, bolting up the floor. Bunn with the 3, and that one airballs into the arms of Keene, and he's hacked.
It was a wasted, I know he wanted to get the shot off. The clock is running down, but shooting over a taller defender, fading away, three-pointer.
You don't have a lot of time, but you still want to be able to make sure you get the best shot available in a quick amount of time. And it looked like he got himself out of control, forcing that shot up.
Yeah, it really looked like they're trying to get a two-for-one quickly there, and it just didn't pan out.
Keene has been clutch, nothing less.
Yeah, he's been rock solid in this half.
I'm going to keep my mouth shut for the last 30 seconds of this game, let the players play it out, as that one's stolen away, but Williams, with his foot dragging on the line, will give it back to the Coyotes. 33 seconds remaining.
So we have an injury here.
Injury here that we can't see.
I am going to. It's Keene. And he looks like he may have been poked in the eye. We've got the staff is going to look at him now.
All right, he's walking. He's all right enough to make it to the bench. Give him a round of applause.
Not sure where he was. He was way off the floor. The referees finally noticed that Keene wasn't on the floor. So he walks over to the bench as Griffin gets it with 30 seconds remaining here. Gets the defender on his back, gets the shot to go, and 1.
Oh, that's huge. That is huge. Is it enough? Is it enough with 26.8 left?
He can cut it to 4, and they've got to get. They're not going for the quick stop, we know. They're going to go straight for the foul.
How quickly things change. Keene injured, been one of their best performers in the second half. He's on the sideline.
And that one falls. We've got a close one as they get tight D. And Bethea is going to get fouled. I'm going to wave that shot off, but he will go to the line.
24.8 on the official clock here. These are big free throws.
Somebody back out the game, but it is still a game. Wow.
Do we have a foul out? There's some talk on the sideline. That's ice water right there.
Clutch free throw from Bethea. And that one's off. And Keithan gets it and a quick steal.
Oh.
And that's pretty much going to cap the game. Smart play by Richardson and a not smart play by McKeithen. Griffin forces up the three. That one rattles out.
That's
and Richardson with it.
We got a foul. 9 seconds, 10 seconds, I guess.
10 seconds remaining. And it looks like the Thunder are going to go home with the Northern Conference title, with the shot at the major title coming up next week.
They came, they used their bench effectively. They hit their free throws when it mattered. And they kept their cool. And we can only hope that Keen is all right. He's over on the bench. He seems like he's okay, or at least well enough to be partaking in this.
And I'm sure a trophy will make him feel a little bit better as that one's short. And a nice save, almost hit the rafters, but it didn't. And it falls into the hands of Bethea.
You guys, I got the perfect.
And a late foul.
Them boys the
that shot should count.
You see Keen is up and running and walking around getting some Gatorade. He looks like he's laughing a little bit, so that's good.
And the Northern Conference Championship will stay here with the Thunder as they will take on the victor of our next matchup coming up here soon between the Carolina Crusaders and the Primetime Players. As the final horn blows, stay with us here on Netcast Sports. We've got a great one coming up. Possibly, might be difficult to make it even better than this last one. So, boy, you will have to stay with us to find out along with us here on Netcast Sports. I'm Chase Vaden. Thank you. We'll see you in just a few minutes.